Good morning, everybody. We needed to get everybody into the room so I can get a little heat in here. It's a little chilly for San Diego. I'd like to welcome everybody to the 13th annual John Hansbrough Memorial Lecture. And I'm going to take just a few minutes to introduce Dr. Hansbrough to you. Dr. Coimbra then will introduce our guest speaker, who we're very privileged to have from Massachusetts General Hospital, Dr. Ron Tompkins. But I'd like to start today and just mention a few facts about Dr. Hansbrough that I think are important. And then I'd like to talk about something that's kind of been on my mind for quite a while related to Dr. Hansbrough. And, so bear with me today. Dr. Hansbrough was born in 1946, went to undergraduate school at probably the best university in the world, the University of Wisconsin Badgers, and then went on to Harvard to get his medical education. Then went to the University of Colorado, Denver, where he did his residency, and later stayed on as a faculty member. Those are the days when people did an awful lot with very little, which is kind of our mantra now. But he ran at that time the burn unit at the University of Colorado, the surgical intensive care unit, and the emergency department at a time in which emergency medicine used to be under general surgery. So quite a bit of work to do there. He was recruited by Dr. Musa here in 1984, and correct me if I'm wrong, was it yourself or Dr. Musa who recruited him, Dr. Orlov? Doctor, did you recruit Dr. Hansbrough, or did Dr. Musa recruit him? All right, and I want to give you full credit. Dr. Orloff, in his infinite wisdom, recruited John here to UCSD in 1984, and for 17 years he was the director of the UCSD Burn Center. At that time, it was living in a small corner of the fifth floor of the hospital, not even anything resembling an actual center. And he saw that grow with the help of his wife, Wendy Hansbrough, who was the nurse manager for the Burn Center, into actually what you see today upstairs. They led the final construction and planning for that. When you look at his work related to academic medicine, he was a prolific writer. I sat down with him once and I said, Dr. Hansbrough, so give me the pearls. How do you write like you do? And he looked at me in utter disbelief. He said, you sit in front of the computer and you just type. I said, well, that doesn't work for all of us. He goes, it should. And what he said was, you had to have a beginning and you had to have an end. You had to have your data to support your conclusions, and you had to just sit there, become organized, put your thoughts down, and then you had to devote time to do that. What I thought his knack was, besides just having the words flow into his mind, he could be typing 1 minute, go over to the burn center the next minute, check on some patients, come back and sit down at the computer and begin right where he left off. A trait that I think is very difficult to do. He had numerous research grants, numerous fellows, both national and international, that he has trained. I think probably one of his biggest joys that he worked on with his wife was to make the UCSD Burn Center an excellent clinical facility here. We are the only burn center in San Diego County. Everything comes here, so you have to be good. You have to be able to take care of the patients. And he worked tirelessly with Wendy to make that happen. Very demanding professor. Needed to be done on time. Whether it was on the wards, 7 o'clock they were rounding Monday through Friday. Saturday was 6 o'clock because we had grand rounds at that time up here at the VA. But 7365, you could always see Dr. Hansbrough here. To me, this is where I thought his love was, though. His love was doing clinical research and really bench research. He was always a man full of ideas, thoughts, thinking about how to make something better, how to build a better mousetrap. When I thought back and said to myself, you know, what were his main interests, and went through it, his publications and looked at it, I think, to me, his biggest love over the years was related to trying to develop tissue substitutes, bioengineering of a new dermal substitute, a new epidermal substitute, both on a temporary basis and on a permanent basis. He also enjoyed, I think, working on neuroendocrine problems as they're related to burn patients, hypermetabolic response, feeding, nutrition, all those things that relate to long-term outcomes and improved outcomes in the patients. PTSD, how could we avoid this in patients? How could we mitigate this? He was very, very interested in those types of areas. But I think he was best when he was collaborating with his cronies around the country. And I think Dr. Tompkins will allude to a little bit of that. He was always on the phone talking. He was always at a meeting, brainstorming with somebody, bouncing his ideas off, and then coming back here just with a lot of work for us to do. Education, as I knew him, became, I think, a very important part of his psyche. I would term it as long-term education. He was looking for ways to educate people without having to be right in front of them. He was interested in computer-based education, modules. Now we call them little podcasts. But he was kind of working on that long before it became popular to do. He partnered with the U.S. Navy to develop a lot of education and training programs that could be sent out on the ships, sent out to the tip of the spear, so that people would have these resources. And I think he was best when he was behind the camera here, he and Pat doing the actual videotaping themselves. He was real big on outreach, particularly with paramedics and fire rescue within the community. I think his teachings have landed well with John Nordenbouts, who has gone out and continued this outreach for us here within the county. One other area that I think was important is John knew how to press the flesh and how to forge partnerships and how to make deals with people so as to improve the burn care here in San Diego County. Here he's talking with Ron Roberts, one of the county supervisors. Well, it turns out there's a story there. Ron Roberts, his wife worked here for a long time at the university, that had some burn injuries within their family. And these little ties that begin with just taking care of patients forge into relationships that help improve the care of patients throughout San Diego County. And whether he was working with someone as important as Ron Roberts or whether he was just down at the local fairgrounds trying to make inroads and how to get some of his educational programs going, he was always active. But I want to talk today a little bit on something that I've never talked about with you guys. I want to talk just for a moment on John's death. I want to talk about something that maybe we can learn, not only through the things that he taught us during his life, but things that he's hopefully we will learn through his death. John took his own life in 2001, a great loss for his family, a great loss for UCSD. And I wish we were sitting here celebrating his life with him here able to talk to us. I think he would be 69 or 70 today, Wendy. And I'm sure he'd be like Dr. Arloff, still with his white coat on, still coming to work every day. So let's just digress just for a minute and take on this topic, and then we'll return to the celebration of life. If you look at major risk factors for suicide, depression, bipolar disorders, or alcohol abuse are three of the leading problems that we have here. In John's case, he was afflicted with depression, and it was something that had bothered him throughout his adult life. There's been a lot of work done, specifically related to physicians and suicide or healthcare workers and suicide. Particularly, the American College of Surgeons thought this was important enough to actually conduct a study in 2007 to look at it. What I'm quoting you right now is from an article from the JAMA that actually Wendy Hansbrough helped author after John's death. And the one thing that I'd like to talk about here is stress. Personal stress, professional stress, or financial stress are major risk factors for suicide ideation or suicide completion. Some of the things in physician surveys that they talk about that are causing increased stress include the increased burden of administrative duties, which just every month seem to be bigger and bigger, and nobody carves any time out of it. A loss of physician autonomy as we begin to do things more and more alike. Excessive professional demands, long work hours, little vacation time, but to me that equates to little family time. Because if you look at these studies, one of the things that actually decreases your risk of suicide is good family and personal relationships. And also the topic of burnout has become important here. If you look at this graph here, this is a graph or a table that looks at satisfaction with work-life balance based by specialty. And if you look there in the middle, that's the mean area. And general surgery and general internal medicine are sitting just above and below that line, if you will. But if you go ahead and you look at burnout here, you'll see that while general surgery and general surgery subspecialties are just a little bit below the mean, that still represents about 40% of us are not happy or feel that we're burned out by what we do. Not a very good statistic or fact to know. Well, physicians, heal thyself, right? Only 35% of us actually have doctors that we see on any regular basis. We wouldn't be too happy if our patients were like that. If we look at the lifetime prevalence of suicidal ideation in physicians compared to our general population, it's about the same. So what's different? Look at the relative risk at the bottom there of suicide, between 1 and 3.4 times in males. And this really surprised me. What's going on with the women in surgery? There are some significant things that we need to look at that look at this disparity. Because in the general population, the suicide ratio of men to women is 4 to 1 men, okay? And clearly here it's reversed. So there's something that we need to find out a little bit more about and work on. Suicide ideation among surgeons, this was done by the American College of Surgeons, and Wendy, I have to think that Dave Hoyt somehow has his hand in this study, although he's not listed as an author. It's 3.3% suicide ideation in the general population. In surgeons, it's double that. The prevalence increases with age. It's interesting here. If you look age 45 to 64, the rates of suicide ideation increase. And then as we go past 65, we seem to settle down and go back to more normal population characteristics. 7.2% of us sought help for issues related to depression or bipolar disease, whereas 44% of the general population do so. Look at the major risk factors here. Screening positive for depression, 7 times the odds ratio, almost 2 times. Perceived a major medical error, you know, we get involved in these from time to time as a stressor, and slightly older surgeon manifested by the surrogate of a child who's in college, it also increases the risk. So what can we do? What can we do to help ourselves? We can establish regular sources of personal health care. We can seek health care when we're having difficulties, whether it's actual medical, surgical, psychological, or psychiatric help. Feel free to do so. Recognize that the medical boards throughout the country are becoming more progressive towards this. And rather than punitive damages being applied to you because you're asking for help, many of the boards now are encouraging this type of behavior. Utilize the local mental health things that you have here. We actually have an office here at UCSD that works with us when we're having difficulty. Call them up, ask for help. But more importantly, look at your neighbor, look at your coworker. Determine whether they're exhibiting risk factors that might make you worried. Sit and talk with them and have a conversation. Routinely screening for patients for depression, suicide ideation, domestic violence, just makes you smarter for thinking about it for yourself. John, as I mentioned, liked to work with the Navy. This is what the Navy does. It makes things very simple. Simple acts of kindness make a difference, and they may save a life. Ask, care, and treat. And those are the thoughts that I'd like to leave you with today. And now, I'd like to turn it over to Dr. Raul Coimbra to introduce Dr. Ron Tompkins. I think we can best celebrate John's lifetime by having a great lecture here, talking about great science with a great physician. So, Dr. Coimbra and Dr. Tompkins.
Thank you all for coming. This is obviously a special day for the Division of Trauma, Burns, and Critical Care. I want to thank particularly Wendy Hansbrough and John Jr. For coming this morning. Marshall, thanks for coming. And it's my great pleasure to introduce to you a friend who will deliver the John Hansbrough Memorial Lecture, Dr. Ronald Tompkins. Ron did his undergrad and obtained his MD degree at Tulane, did his general surgery residency at MGH. Took several years off during his surgical training and obtained a Master's of Science in Chemical Engineering at MIT. Continued on to obtain a higher doctorate degree in Medical and Chemical Engineering at MIT. This is all during residency. And then later obtained an honorary MA degree from Harvard. He did his fellowship at Harvard and MIT as well. His first faculty appointment at Harvard was in 1985. From 1996 to 2007, he was the John Franco Burke Professor in Surgery. And from 2007 until today, he's the Sumner M. Redstone Professor of Surgery. He was the Trauma Director at MGH for 10 years, the Burn Director for 25 years at MGH and Shriners. And currently, he's the Director of the Center for Surgery, Innovation, and Bioengineering at MGH. Outside of Harvard, obviously, Ron has many activities and jobs in professional organizations. He was an active director of the American Board of Surgery from 1994 to 2000. And from 2000 until today, he is one of the senior directors of the American Board of Surgery. Last week, he was just in Dallas giving the boards. He's been the past president of the American Burn Association, the International Society of Burn and Injury, the International Surgical Group, and the Halstead Society. Obviously, a man of his caliber, he is a reviewer of all prestigious science and medical journals. I could go on and recite everything that's in his CV. I think that his most remarkable work you're going to hear about today is the GRU grant for the Inflammation and Host Response to Injury Collaborative, which is a multi-institutional study in trauma burn patients, which to me is the largest collection of patient samples and relevant clinical data for genomic and proteomic analysis to date. So you're going to hear a lot about the GRU grant today, which is going to be a treat for us. He travels around the world. He has trained 277 fellows in 25 years, 87 of them directly under his mentorship. His current funding is $17 million, but he, in the last 25 years, was responsible for bringing to the Harvard system more than $200 million in federal funding. So he is untouchable at Harvard, and a man that has made tremendous contributions with almost 500 publications, 3 theses, and he has been cited 14,000 times. So I'm telling you all this because when we talk about a triple threat, that's what a triple threat is, somebody that talks the talk and walks the walk. So it's a great pleasure for us to bring one of the giants in burn and trauma surgery in the country to tell us about genomics of injury, the GRU grant experience. Ron.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much. Just listening, it seems like a crazy eclectic kind of a course. I'm really delighted to be here. I got to enjoy yesterday at the Hillcrest campus and the Burn and Trauma Service, and it was actually a very pleasant, very, very pleasant day. I'm delighted to be here and to see Wendy. My wife is going to expect a report on this. I knew John quite well. We were both very interested in artificial skin at the time, and John was my West Coast colleague. In that regard, and I really enjoyed my relationship with John. So, I think John actually would have enjoyed this opportunity. What we're going to talk about is the GRU grant, and it came when a number of technologies were becoming available, and I knew they were going to be used in cancer and stroke and all kinds of other disease processes, but frankly, I thought that trauma should have an opportunity for once to be on the cutting edge of science and understanding about human care. And I'm going to give you a little bit of a primer on how genomics works if you're injured seriously enough to be to die? And how does your system respond genomically and proteomically to something that's serious enough to kill you? And that, I think John would appreciate this understanding. This is a little bit about what had occurred. The human genome was sequenced. The HapMap project was well along to understanding. And at the time, these were microarrays that were readily available. And our colleagues at Stanford were really leaders in that regard. What was the clinical paradigm probably 15 years ago? And it's stuff that we teach in the ICU even today, in which there's a systemic inflammatory response syndrome after a serious injury over a few days, let's say 4 or 5 days, there's a compensatory anti-inflammatory response syndrome. If you do in vitro studies, you see T cells don't proliferate and things don't work well in the adaptive immune system. And sometimes if you have a so-called second hit, then you can have a much greater incidence of organ dysfunction, systemic surge response, and injury and death. And that's what we've been teaching. What we'll talk about from the glue grant is to understand that that is nonsense from a transcriptome perspective. And although phenomenologically this is what we see in the ICU, from a transcript and a genomic perspective, it's utter nonsense. The Glue Grant was an interesting organization. It was 100 successful independent investigators from 17. We started off with 22 academic organizations, and we fired 5 of them, and ended up with 17 that started in 2001 over the next 10 years. And it ultimately cost about $100 million, so it's not a minor level endeavor. What was nice is we had these microarrays, we had some high-throughput proteomics, we developed some technologies in the area of microfluidics, and a massive challenge in computational biology. We had never really collected this massive amount of information before. So there were whole new computational systems that had to be developed. But when you do all that, you get a tremendous database. And how do you get real useful clinical information when you have so much data? And so how do molecules interact to create processes that we actually care about? We care about things like apoptosis and innate immunity and metabolism, things that actually are things that are seen in our patients every day. So let me talk a little bit of some of the technical details. We entered almost 3,000 patients, the vast majority of which were what we call epidemiologic. We didn't do blood sampling because blood sampling, all the analytical aspects related to that are incredibly expensive. We sampled blood from a subset, the first half of time, 187 trauma patients and about 250 burn patients taking blood. We also took muscle, fat, skin, and then we had an additional 250 trauma patients in which we looked at T cells, monocytes, and neutrophils separately because they all behave a little bit differently. We never did get to this special regulatory cell response over the course, but that was originally a plan. This is just a little bit of a summary of what the relational databases look like. And we collected a lot of information. There are more than 80,000 tissue samples, that was blood, plasma, and such. Lots of these microarrays, and I'll spend a little bit of time talking about this affymetrix microarrays because it's a way of actually identifying how each human gene changes over time and doing it in a high throughput manner. We also had functional proteomics, the 9-color flow cytometry, some high throughput mass spectroscopy, which is also done here on the West Coast, up in Washington State, and quite a number of other
assays. Just to give you a sense of genomically how things happen, let me just start off talking about this first 167 patient, severe blunt trauma. They got a blood sample as soon as they arrived in the hospital, and the next day, 4 days, 7, 14, 28 days until they were discharged. You have to compare that with normal, and we use this particular array early on. And these are two computational approaches that had to be developed in order to begin to understand. Just to give you a sense, Ron Mayer was our, from Harborview, led our trauma effort, and David Herndon, our burns effort from the clinical side. And there were seven level one trauma centers across the country. Yet the requirement was presenting with shock and requiring a blood transfusion within the first few hours. It took us a year and a half sitting down with sort of the Delphi method about standard protocols and how to work together. And that actually ultimately ended up with three of the centers fired because they couldn't actually manage external audits in terms of following standard operating procedures. It was kind of an interesting deal. Average ISS of 32, which is really, these are really major trauma, totally all blunt trauma, with an incidence of organ failure of 35%. 13 days in the ICU, 10 days on the ventilator, and we started, the overall average mortality was 17%. It started out about 24%, and then over the course of time, that mortality reduced to an average of about 12%. And we blame the fact that there was adherence to standard operating procedures, and got a publication, actually, for that. And I honestly think that a lot of it had to do with blood conservation and other standard procedures. In terms of, this was sort of the organ failure. If there are some patients out of this almost 1,700 patients, some patients come in and their degree of organ failure is quite minimal, if at all. A few patients have initial organ failure, so and then resolve rather quickly. Red here is severe organ failure that is persistent. And you see there are some patients who have serious organ failure and go on to die. Black is death. What we were interested in, were there any patients in which it was rather red, became blue, and then became red again, such that you would see in a second hit phenomena. But it turns out that out of these 700 patients, there was only one that you might actually think that happened. Frankly, organ failure either develops very early and ultimately resolves or doesn't resolve. This notion of a second hit, in which there's an incidence of organ failure followed by CARS, followed by a second organ dysfunction event, honestly doesn't happen. At least in the 1,700 trauma patients. This was the mortality rate very early on, and it was in the mid-20s, but over the course of the last 4 or 5 years, that settled down to about 12%. If you compare those overall rates with TRIS and ISS and Apache and such, these were the national figures, and these were the mortality rates in the GLU grant program. So we were very proud of the fact that actually we made some clinical progress with this program. our detractors or the reviewers, we all know how hard it is to actually get things funded through the NIH. And so we had our own on reviewers. And one of the big deals, they said, you know, the way my genome responds and the genes that I'm expressing are so different than yours, that there's no way in the world that you're going to be able to find any consistent differences or similarities. And so we said, okay, we realize that's conventional wisdom. We don't believe you, but, and eventually we prevailed. The reviewers were so outrageous. There are actually some names I could share with you you'd recognize. but we overcame them. And so the program was funded. We were very careful with the methodologies that we used, and this are sort of some of the microarrays that were available. And this has to do with the variance. If you take a sample and try it twice, or you prepare it twice, you have a very narrow variance. This has to do within a single individual. Let's a blood sample today and a blood sample, let's say, tomorrow, and you're looking at all human genes, so about 20,000 or so human genes, and looking to see how you differ from today and tomorrow as a single individual. This is the variance that you would get between two individuals, and certainly there is greater variance. Not all the genes that I express at rest are going to be the same as yours, so it's a little bit different, and the variance and with individual genes is actually a little broader. But it turns out between trauma patients, the variance is even less than between two healthy individuals. We actually become more alike under serious stress than at rest. And our methodology is tight enough to be able to identify that. I have one other point that I think sometimes we don't actually think about. Expression is like politics, it's local. And it depends exactly the tissues that you're looking at. If you look at genomic DNA, any regular cell in my body has hopefully the same DNA sequence. However, expression depends on the tissue evaluated. And so here is about 1,600 genes, and these were in burn patients. So this is a heat map, and green really means the gene is expressed lower than some average, some normal. And red is a number of transcripts that is higher than normal. So red is considered expression, and green is considered non-expression or suppression. And so this is blood, and so these 1,600 genes, here's about a third of them or fewer, are being expressed, and the rest of the genes are not expressed in blood. But if you look at those same genes in skin, there's about two-thirds of them does have some degree of expression of those very same genes. Here in muscle, it's a really different repertoire of genes that are being expressed. And it turns out a lot of in muscle have to do with metabolism and synthesis of certain components. And then fat is even different from that. So when you're looking at expression, you have to be very careful of the cells that you're evaluating because they can be very different. So this is it. So I just to give you a notion here, and we'll talk about this in a little bit, over 80% of your human genes respond when you've had an injury serious enough to kill you. Looking at the buffy coat in blood, 80% of the genome. There really is no other example in science in which there is such a genomic storm that occurs. Every single gene that's possible to respond changes significantly. And if you look at, and these are like false discovery rates and fold changes, even at 1.5-fold difference, there's still 10,000 genes that change over those 28 days. And if you get to a two-fold change, there's down to 5,000 genes that change statistically. So we were trying to figure out how you begin to analyze something like this. And so we're looking at blood at buffy coat, and so it's a mixture of primarily neutrophils. When you have a serious injury, the vast majority of the cellular response is neutrophilic. The lymphocytes actually hide. They go into the peripheral tissues, and you have T regulatory and all kinds of, there's a lot of literature about lymphocytic responses after injury, but for the most part, it's not in circulating blood. It's hidden in the tissues. And monocytes, the monocytes are macrophages, just like the neutrophils, and they're very active after serious injury. And I draw your attention here, those are those 5,000 genes. there's 5,000 horizontal, and each one of those horizontals is a gene. And so what you have here are normals, and out of those 5,000 genes, a little over half of them are not normally expressed, and they are normally expressed in maybe about half of them. You find some genes, like up here, in which they're not normally expressed, they're turned on, and within 12 hours or so, they're turned off again. So there would be a pattern in which you would pick something like IL-1 or TNF, which is turned on immediately after these serious injuries. It upregulates a lot of the inflammatory cascades, but it's also just as quickly turned off. And so there are genes up here in that kind of a category. There's some weird ones in the middle that we don't have time to talk about. And there's a lot, most of the genes are actually turned off. And as you can imagine, this is the Buffy code. So not almost all of these pathways, these are looking not only at individual genes, but now trying to integrate them into pathways. Almost all of these are related to inflammatory cells. You're looking at white cells, so you'd expect it to be related to the inflammatory or the immune system. In upregulated pathways, actually 8 out of 10 are innate immune genes, or innate immune pathways, and 9 out of 10 of the downregulated pathways, as expressed in the Buffy code, are related to the adaptive immune system. And these are P's that are 10 to the minus 10 and 10 to the minus 13. These are highly significantly regulated pathways. And so we were sort of wondering, you know, they said burn. Why? So we had a number of different. We had a wonderful group from UMDNJ, and they were studying endotoxin in Princeton students, and so we used that as a method to begin to understand how our system operates. And so we have an endotoxin group, and we have burns more than 20% and trauma. And we were kind of interested how, out of those 5,000 genes, how does burn injury and trauma compare? Are they going to be very different genomically? Our reviewers said they're going to be amazingly. It depends on how you're injured. It changes things. And it turns out that in this major bone trauma, there were 2,066 genes that were regulated more than twofold. And in burns, that was identical group of genes. And there were 3,000 genes that were identically behaving in both burns and trauma. And there were only 9 that behaved differently and 19 out of those more than 5,000 genes. So it turns out that actually trauma is a pretty darn good model, genomically speaking, for humans for burns. And it's highly reproducible. There were a number of ways of looking at this. You're talking about injuries that are really serious. So any gene that's available to respond has responded in a significant fashion. But it's just amazing how reproducible that is between what otherwise would appear to be two very different disease processes. In my opinion, this is really just a severe stress response, and it's something that we would see in many other things as a maximal response. In this particular case, we're looking at those Princeton students with LPS versus trauma. And you can see there's a great deal of similarity, even with a little squirt of endotoxin in an otherwise normal young person. If you look at Pearson's correlation, so you're trying to get a notion of how these genes behave, the R or R square is 0.91. 91% of the variance is explained when you're either looking at burns or trauma. It's a highly reproducible process. It's extraordinary. And it certainly wasn't something our reviewers thought would ever happen. Let me give you a couple of examples. Things that you know are going to be important are TLRs, toll-like receptors. There's a whole series of receptors that are molecules that are either intrinsic, that are not normally seen, that are potentially damaging, DAMPs, or it's organisms or external molecules that are molecular patterns that our system over the ages knows is a bad thing. And so there are innate responses to them. And the TLR4, you know, from endotoxin, but there's just a plethora of them that are related to DNA and RNA viruses and a number of other things. The RNA and the DNA viruses are suppressed, but all the other ones are very highly upregulated. And so this red is an expression of a receptor or a ligand involved in the process, or an intracellular cell signaling molecule. And you can see that there's a great deal of upregulation, as one might expect, with in this case, blunt trauma. This is an example of burns. And although, you know, burns goes on for months, if not years, trauma is usually something that resolves within 28 days and by a few months. Even if you have severe injury, most patients are beginning to resolve if you solve their mechanical problem. And so you're talking two very different time periods with burns and with trauma, but in terms of the genes involved, it's amazingly comparable. And here, with that little single squirt of endotoxin, which you get a little flu syndrome that lasts for a few hours, and we send them home at 24 hours, there's an amazing similarity to the number of genes and the manner in which they respond, as you see with very serious injuries. If you look here, it's just not that big a difference in terms of degree. So we were interested in, you know, you're hit by a car, a truck, or whatever, and you respond to the injury, and maybe you do quite well and go home, or you're a little older and you stay up in the ICU and now you're collecting complications. You've got some ileus and you remain unconscious, and you know how we treat them in the ICU. And on the left here, so we have what we call uncomplicated. And imagine a 20-year-old, and he runs into a tree, gets a concussion, rib fractures, pulmonary contusion, maybe a spleen, and fractures a femur. He's certainly going to bleed into some sort of hypovolemic shock. Makes it to the emergency room. You ride the femur and you deal with the spleen, and they wake up and you get them off the ventilator. 4 or 5 days later, you're thinking about sending them home, and you wonder genomically how does he differ from, let's say, a 55-year-old had exactly the same injury, but still up on he's still in the ICU on the ventilator collecting complications. We see these patients all the time. Genomically speaking, how are they different? Well, it turns out that young man that you're sending home is genomically grossly abnormal, but clinically doing well enough to be sent home, whereas the guy in the ICU is still up there collecting complications, but genomically there really is. Here to the left are 55 patients of the young uncomplicated, and then to the right is that complicated patient sitting in the ICU, and you're looking at his buffy coat. And now we tortured the data, and we can find quantitative differences. Qualitatively, there's not one iota of differences. There's not a single gene that's behaving differently in that young man you're sending home than in that that older patient that's in the ICU. What happens is genes, and genes don't typically turn on and off. They respond over the first 6 to 9 hours, and then they resolve ultimately over some differing time periods during the course of the hospital stay, and even later, even 4 years. Here we have a number, there are only 63 genes that actually were different at the twofold level. You find in the uncomplicated, the genes change and resolve a little sooner than if you're complicated. But there are no different gene behaviors. We were looking to see, is there any cytokine differences between those two? And of course you have your usual suspects: IL-6, IL-1 receptor antagonist, IL-8, whatever that means. There were some cytokine differences. There are no white cell differences. Of those 63 genes, there are some differences, and we were curious, so that there's a genomic signature that's associated with an uncomplicated course that is quantitatively different signature than someone who's having a complicated course. Now, this gives us an interesting opportunity. What if you could change what is an unfavorable genomic signature by drugs? And we'll talk about this in just a moment. And what if you could change the genomic signature? Would that change a thing about the clinical course? This is something that's very interesting and being studied in cancer, in the field of cancer, because your genomic signature is related to cancers, and if you were able to give drugs to change those genomic signatures back to a more normal pattern, would you be able to actually affect cancer care? And the same opportunity exists in trauma. It turns out of those 63 genes that are different, we picked about two-thirds of them here, there's many of them are downstream of interferons. And the issue is downstream of the interferons, which is the response that you get after serious injury, it appears that interferon is not as functional in the complicated patient as it is in normal. So it begs, if you were to give exogenous interferon, could you improve those signatures and make them look more successful, or more normal-like? There's a whole group, this is MHC class 2, which is all downstream of interferons, and their transcripts are low in the complex patient. This is a whole bunch of interferon-responsive genes, and these are a bunch of weird ones here that we don't completely understand. So this sort of begs whether an interferon gamma study should be done. Just a quick summary here. Over 80% of the genome changes after you've been hit by a car bad enough to kill you. And if you look at twofold change, there's at least 5,000 genes. It's very long-lasting. In burns, it lasts for well over a year. And some genes never return to normal. You have them, they're abnormal for epigenetically for probably the rest of your life. 8 out of 10 families are in the innate system. 9 out of 10 are suppressed in the adaptive immunity. The response that you get in the ICU after major injury is an innate immune response. That's what it is. And the adaptive response, although is very elegant, and a lot of us have made our careers writing about it, it's really the innate response that you're dealing with in the ICU after serious burns and in trauma. There are only 63 genes that are different, that behave differently, and it's a quantitative difference. It's not a qualitative difference at all. And so if you take innate genes in a complicated patient, they rise a little higher and last a little longer, but they're the same genes. And in the uncomplicated, it's a little lower and more brief. And adaptive is an immediate response, and it's actually a mirror image. So this is the paradigm that we've been teaching, and it really has to do with phenomenology, SIRS, and CARS. But if you look at it transcriptionally, there's an immediate innate immune response that lasts until the drivers of the system allow these genomic changes to resolve. There's controversy whether there's active resolution or whether there's passive resolution. Passive resolution is you have drivers of the system that are creating these genomic abnormalities as opposed to actively suppressing them. And there are compounds these days that actively suppress inflammation and might play a major role in the future. I didn't want to end without just a little bit of a comment about how mice and all of us make a career out of. And so the question, now that we know a great deal about how the human response works, what about mice? And this created a major amount of controversy. So this is where we're talking about human burn trauma. We're looking at all the genes, and there's a 91% Pearson correlation. So genes behave quite well, and even a 47% if you're looking at endotoxemia. So let's see, how does a mouse burn and a mouse trauma? And these are models done by real experts. not just us. And if you look at that same correlation, there are only about 13 genes, 13% of genes actually behave comparably in both of those. Mouse doesn't even reproduce itself very well. And endotoxemia, the correlation is actually zero. So that's okay. Maybe mouse doesn't really reproduce it, between burns and trauma the same. How does a mouse burn and, let's say, a human burn? It's like 8%. And so just to remind you, random is zero. So on a molecule-to-molecule basis, if you're looking to see how a particular gene behaves in the mouse in burn injury model versus in truly in humans, there's an 8% possibility of the gene behaving the same. Zero is a coin toss. And it's not to say that maybe that's not fair. You're looking on a molecule-to-molecule basis. Mice aren't people. We know that. So let's look at pathways. Pathways are very important. And Fc-mediated phagocytosis, that's a pathway that's very, very important for us to survive serious injuries. And burns and trauma in humans are highly reproducible. This is at point. This is at 91%. Those pathways behave in burns and trauma almost identically. Even with endotoxemia, it's more than 60%. The pathways are behaving identically. And this is the way they're behaving in mice. And this is looking at a whole pathway, you know? There's hundreds of genes in a pathway, and you sort of look, how's the pathway behaving? And it's not behaving at all the same, even if you look at it on a pathway. And so let's look in the literature. What's available in GO and all over? And so this is burns, this is trauma, and you're looking at R-squares. This is R-square of 0.91, and almost 100% of the genes are behaving identically, both in burns and trauma. This is one of his genomic studies. This is in the area of sepsis. This is endotoxemia. This has to do with ARDS. This is reproducibility in human disease, how genes behave, looking at the GEO database, and this is sort of the mouse. And even the mouse, and you're using the mouse analogs of the human genes. But even if you flipped it around and did it, no matter how you do it, the genes just simply don't behave identically in reproducibility. There are quite a number of other things here, but I really don't want to go into it in any great level of detail. I would say I don't really mean to damn mouse model. Yeah, there's no other way to study a lot of our molecules, and understanding mechanisms is really extremely important. So it was only fair to me to point out a couple of animal models where it works really nicely. Rheumatoid arthritis, we learned a great deal in rats. We learned a great deal about COX inhibitors and non-steroidals from these models because we modeled it very nicely in the animal. And in the mouse, we learned a great deal about cytokines and how that works in arthritis. And those are wonderful, but we were modeling in the mouse something that was very important for a human disease. It's not the mouse's fault. We don't understand human disease well enough and actually to create the models. And it just causes me to think that we need to spend more time actually studying human disease in humans rather than depending on a mouse to accurately reflect a human disease. If you think about human pneumonia, it's often in an older individual who's been smoking for decades and it developed a little viral disease and ultimately ends up with walking pneumonia serious enough to kill you. Now, a mouse is going to be an adolescent growing animal, furry little animal that lives in a cage. And during their adolescent life, you've now introduced an organism and maybe brushed up their mucosa, and that bears almost no resemblance to human disease whatsoever. So we really shouldn't blame the mouse We just don't know how to model it appropriately. And we have a number of genome-wide expressions and high-throughput technologies these days to get much more information from humans, and we have a lot of functional imaging. And I would strongly recommend that we pay more attention to human disease rather than and working out individual models in mice. I rushed through this last part, but I hope you got an appreciation at least for how genomics seems to work in humans, and thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Ron. I think we have time for a couple questions. Brian?
I ended up with quite a number of fights with nature, and actually, if you look at nature over the last probably 7 or 8 years, almost 2/3 or more of the current publications all actually have at least some human examples where whatever mechanism they're studying, they've tried to find at least some evidence that particular gene or molecule plays a role in human disease. And I think the editors have consciously tried to be sure, and they give a much higher priority if it can be a completely basic science mirroring study, but any element that would suggest that it plays any kind of a relevant role in human to include it in a publication, I think is a really good thing. We can't do everything we want, any much of anything that we want to do in humans, but we can have an onus to try to have some element of information that would justify the fact that that molecule or mechanism plays a relevant role in humans. And I think that that's a very good thing. And I think more of a onus to do that is appropriate. In my opinion, if you look at things like efficacy and toxicity is, you know, you have two animals, you can have a small animal and a large animal, and it turns out toxicity is almost a random event, whether it's relevant in humans. And, you know, in humans, we give medications over, you know, often years or decades for chronic diseases, and you never test that in animals. And just because it's a large animal, and you know, we all know how dogs have very different responsiveness and toxicities to, you know, plants and such, and so it turns out that safety related to toxicity studies is pretty pathetic, and we're just pretty lucky. We almost randomly eliminate drugs because of toxicity analysis that probably or possibly could be very relevant to humans, but we've eliminated them because they happen to be not well tolerated by rodents or larger animals. It turns out it's rather ridiculous. It's somewhat random. But obviously you can't test toxicity in humans, but we should realize that we're eliminating potentially half the opportunities for something that really is not very rational.
We'll run 17 sites, $100 million, 10 years. Now you have this massive amount of data. How do you see this being used in the next couple of decades to inform us about injury response and ultimately take this back to the bedside? What's next for the Google?
It was an appreciation. an appreciation for the fact that the innate response is what is a two-edged sword, and it is not only necessary for survival, but equally it is harmful. The innate response is something that we've begun to focus a great deal more on. It's not really you have to live long enough to get an adaptive response, but if your innate response doesn't allow your survival, it doesn't matter. And so the innate response is very nonspecific, and it's a two-edged sword. And beginning to understand components of the innate response that are absolutely not necessary, that can be attenuated and reduce some of this innocent bystander damage, is where we need to be, and it's very complicated. And so there's a couple of ways of going at it. One, we can take our favorite component of the innate response and begin to manipulate and understand whether we can attenuate components, and that will help us survive. That's one way. Another way, we got DARPA to fund, and you know, nature has been doing this experiment for a very long time. And it turns out that, for example, if you give endotoxin to rodents, they tolerate a million-fold more endotoxin or bacteria than humans. Humans are way too over-responsive to the environment. And then it's just getting worse. Humans are just way overly responsive, and that our own response is damaging and harmful, and it's not necessary. And so DARPA, it turns out that we and chimpanzees have the same sort of innate response to endotoxin and to bacteria. We're almost identical. Whereas the other six great apes, I don't know, you may not like being called a great ape, but we are one of the eight. But the other six are actually just like rodents. They tolerate dirt and such with no problem. And so it kind of begs, is there something about something that happened a couple million years ago that made us overly sensitive? And so DARPA likes crazy things like that. They're funding a program in which we're studying in primates. Is there some comparable thing with our nearest cousin, chimps? There is a series of proteins or small molecules in plasma that actually suppress macrophages and cause us to be more mouse-like. We're chasing that down. But I think beginning to manipulate some components of the environment such that we are not as overly responsive, and we should become more mouse-like in many ways. The military doesn't like us using the terminology becoming more mouse-like. It's not a macho kind of an approach, but we are overly reactive. And I think at least it turned us in that direction. Of course, we do have predictive algorithms, but prediction and looking at certain pathways to find some drug targets to reduce some of those. That this kind of a database does allow that possibility, and so it did change the paradigm, at least for us.
Yeah. Thank you very much.